Now get us there.
Okay, so tonight I want to give you a quick rundown of how you can add voice control to whatever internet connected appliances or other smart appliances you've got in your home without having to go and buy all new equipment to work with the new harness. So I'll talk about what Apple HomeKit is, some basic terminology that you're going to need to know to understand the problem space. Then I'll talk about what it is that Homebridge does, which is a Node.js application which presents your existing stuff in a way that Apple can understand. And finally, I'll talk about how to write your own plugins for Homebridge and also how to do the equivalent process in Node-RED. So home automation's been around for a lot longer than you think, but the problem is everybody wants to be their own silo. Nothing talks to anything else. So what we're finally seeing is some consolidation where a couple of very large platforms are becoming a lingua franca that can talk to all your devices. Unfortunately, we've ended up with three of them. We've got Amazon, Google, and Apple all going their own way. The reason I chose Apple at the moment is because the other two, it's difficult to get the hardware in Australia. It's only been released in the United States and the UK. And it's the case that with Apple, you can get started with being able to talk to your appliances without having to go out and buy expensive hardware. So Apple HomeKit is a protocol, a coding framework, a hardware specification for being able to intelligently control and identify devices in the home. So that's stuff like your lights, your door locks, your smoke alarms, your burglar alarm, all your power points, your thermostat, whatever. So you can go out and buy all new devices. As I said, you can go to the Apple Store and you can get a HomeKit compatible thermostat and a HomeKit compatible smoke alarm and light bulbs and stuff. But if you've already got stuff, and I bet that most of you probably already do have something that you could be controlling right now. So since iOS 10, Apple ships the home application, which is the control center that you'll need, as well as you will start to see other applications coming which can talk to home devices. Unfortunately, building the devices turns out to be a bit harder. They're restricting that information to members of the Made for iPhone program. So this information that I'm going to give you tonight has basically been reverse engineered around non-disclosures and takedown messages to allow hackers like us to be able to build intelligent devices which can be controlled from your phone. So in the HomeKit space, what you would think of as a device, they call an accessory. So that's one piece of hardware that does one thing. A sensor, an actuator, some kind of appliance. And then you have bridges, and that's what Homebridge is. It's an endpoint in the system which translates for other endpoints. So we're going to have a piece of software which translates the Apple protocol into whatever it is that our TV or our fridge or our smoke detector needs to know. The other useful thing is a concept called scenes. And what a scene is basically a macro, a canned set of changes to your environment that happen when you give a trigger phrase. So that might be, I'm going to do a presentation, and that means turn on all the TVs and dim the lights, or it's time for bed, which means turn off all the lights downstairs, turn on the bedside lamps in the bedroom. And finally, there's a concept of triggers, which means you can say, when these conditions are met, activate this scene. So that could be sunset happens, turn on the driveway lights. Nobody is in the house, turn off the air conditioning. Or it's 6 a.m., turn on the coffee machine. Two more concepts before I get on with some real information. You can divide your house into rooms and assign accessories to rooms, which means you can say things like turn on the lamp in the living room and it'll figure that out from context. And finally, you can group the rooms into zones, which means you can say things like turn off all the lights downstairs. So you've got these devices, you've got an iPhone, what are the modes of interaction? Firstly, there's the Home app, and that gives you basically a swipeable walkthrough of your house room by room, being able to control stuff, the ability to set up scenes and triggers. Secondly, the control center that you get when you swipe up from the bottom of your phone has got a little dashboard with your most common stuff. And thirdly, you can talk to your things through Siri. So here's a couple of quick screenshots from the app. The one on the left is the home page of the home app. So it's got a couple of buttons for scenes, some of my sensor data, and some favorite accessories that I can turn on or off from the front page. On the right there, we've got the control panel, which is quick access with just a swipe up to some key accessories in my house. Then if you swipe through, you would see all the rooms in my house, and here's the one on the left for the bedroom, which has the scenes that apply to that room. So if I'm in that room, I can say, time for bed, and that means turn out the room lights, turn on the bedside lamps. And finally, on the right, we've got an example of some triggers that I've set up. Now, it is the case that to set up triggers, you do need some hardware. You've either got to have an Apple TV, or if you've got an old iPad, you can basically dedicate it to being a fixed device, and it can run the automation hub. But everything else I'm going to talk about, you can do without buying any more hardware. So what can you do with voice interaction? You can say things like turn on the lamp in the study, turn off all the lights downstairs, switch off the pool filter, what's the temperature in the baby's room. You'll get the hang of what you can do, and there's plenty of sites you can go and look at. So as I said before, simple solution, go out and buy all new everything, make sure it's Apple HomeKit compatible, and you're sweet. But you probably, almost certainly, got some not completely dumb appliances in your house that you could be controlling right now. If you've got a garage door made in the last 30 years, it's probably got a remote control. If you've got a TV you bought in the last 5 years, it's probably got Ethernet on the back of it. You've probably got, if you've got security, you've probably got IP cameras. A lot of people have PowerPoints which can be controlled with little radio frequency remotes. Everything in its dog has got an infrared remote in it right now. So Homebridge can translate those legacy protocols into something that Apple can control. So it's a piece of Node.js, you run it on whatever computer you've got in the house, and I'll talk about some cheap alternatives. And it has a plug-in architecture to represent particular accessories. And in NPM, there is well over 350 different plugins for different kinds of accessories. So that could be various brands of light bulb, every smart TV that is made, various kinds of stereo, certain garage door openers, locks, whatever. So if you've got stuff that's got IP, you probably already find there's a plugin for it. It's dead easy to install, just through NPM like anything else. The wiki's got good instructions on how to install them in Windows and compile up all the stuff you'll need there. They look pretty frightening, actually, so I'd say stick to Linux or Mac if it's at all possible. And then once you've installed it, you've got to configure it. So here's a quick example, just showing three accessories as a representative. We've got a bit of configuration for the server itself up the top, and then we've got a list of accessories that this bridge is repeating for. So these are the things that sit behind the bridge. So once you've used the Apple Home app to pair with the bridge, all the devices behind the bridge become visible. So the top one is one of those remote switches that you plug into your PowerPoint, and I've just plugged a lamp into that. Normally you control it with its own remote or its own iPhone app. I've reflashed it so it understands MQTT, and now anything in my house that speaks MQTT can control that. Second one is my smart TV, and I've named this device Damned Television. And I've done that so that I can say, hey Siri, turn down the damned television. And it's, as a father, that is the best thing ever. It's the only time that sentence has ever worked in my house. And finally, at the bottom, we've got an example of a temperature sensor, which again is MQTT. And in reality, I've got something like 13 or 14 different accessories in my config. So, hardware. Now, if you're like me, you probably already own 19 computers, so you've probably got something sitting around that's turned on all the time. If you don't, or for other reasons, you might prefer to use a low-power computer. So Raspberry Pi, the poster child of the hardware hacker, costs about $70 in Australia. Excellent choice. If $70 sounds like a lot of money, there's a Chinese company called Shenzhen Zhongrong, which makes a computer called the Orange Pi in a bunch of different configurations. And they have a model that's basically equivalent to the Raspberry Pi, but costs $40. And they've got ones which can cost as little as $15 shipped. And one of the reasons you might choose a single board computer over just a PC is you may want to bridge to infrared devices or radio frequency devices and plug a little transceiver module into the Pi, so that when you say turn on the air conditioner, it transmits that via infrared to your aircon. So the kinds of things you can talk to with Homebridge: TVs, Hi-Fis, incumbent home automation platforms, so things like the Philips Hue lighting system. Now, if you buy one now, it's already HomeKit compatible, but if you bought a Hue last year, it didn't speak HomeKit and you've got to go and buy another bridge. So if you don't have to go buy another bridge, you can do it with Homebridge. Smart devices from Wemo, things from Nest, you can use it to turn on and off your computers via WAC on LAN. You can set up scenes which trigger, you know, when my wife comes home, do something by teaching the system what is the MAC address of various people's personal phones. If you, like me, find that your light switches in your house are in positions that were convenient for the builders but terrible for someone who lives in the house, you can buy a thing called an iButton, which is a $5 Bluetooth switch, just a push button, and you stick them on the wall and tell Homebridge, when that button is pushed, turn that light on, and you can remap your light switches so that they're where you want them to be. As I said, anything that's controllable by infrared or RF, you can bridge. And various kinds of sensors, temperature sensors, light sensors. I've got a light sensor in my driveway which tells me when the sun's up, so I can tell certain other lights don't bother turning on during the day. And finally, just added in the most recent release of iOS, you can now talk to cameras. So you can say, show me the security camera in the driveway, and you'll get a picture on your phone. So you want to get started, you've installed the server. What do you do next? You go to NPM, you search for Homebridge-plugin and something that you think might represent your device, and with 382 plugins there's a good chance you'll find one. If you don't, then you build your own. So the no-code way is, hopefully your device already speaks MQTT, which is a message passing protocol beloved of home automation freaks. So if you've got something you can control or inspect via MQTT, there's generic plugins which you can massage to get communication, or you can write your own plugin for Homebridge. And I'm also going to talk briefly about how to write a Homebridge accessory. Sorry, how to write a HomeKit accessory in Node-RED. So before I show you some code, I'll define a couple more terms that you're going to need to know. An accessory offers a service. So a service is a particular thing an accessory can do. Think of it as a class definition. So a service might be light bulb, door lock, power window, sensor. There's about 30, 35 services that Apple define as part of the HomeKit framework. And then services have characteristics. Now, a service will have a certain number of mandatory characteristics that it must implement, and probably a bunch of optional ones. And you can think of a characteristic like a member data of a class. And the characteristics have some standard metadata, the format. So is it an integer, is it a float, is it a string? The units, is it percent, is it degrees Celsius, is it dimensionless, whatever. Minimum, maximum, and whether that characteristic can be read or write, or whether it sends notifications. So that's equivalent to what kind of getters and setters does it have. So an example, to go back to the real world, would be a light bulb, very simple service. At its simplest, you can turn it on or off. Send it a boolean, it goes on or off. Some of the smart light bulbs you can buy are actually multicolor, and you can say, I want you to be pink at 70% brightness, and it'll do that. And you can also, most devices also have a name. And an example where an accessory might have multiple services is if it's battery powered, it's probably also got a battery service which lets you know what's its power level, how long till it's charged, etc. So this is almost all the services that Apple defines. I've been through most of them, so I won't go too deep. But basically, environmental sensing, building entry, appliance control, security, video cameras. So here's an example from the low-level library that HomeBridge uses that implements the HomeKit access protocol, which just shows a good example of some characteristics and how they define. This is actually an interesting use of JavaScript as a domain-specific language almost. They've quite cleverly set up their framework such that the code that defines those characteristics is very close to the documentation of them, so it's quite readable. So to implement a plugin, you have to choose what service type does it implement. So what we're looking at here is the bulk of the code for a service to talk to a smart door lock. So this is a door that can lock and unlock itself. So this implements lock mechanism service type. It has two characteristics called lock current state and lock target state. So what is the state of the lock right now? And what has it been asked to move to? And the code there binds some method functions to those service points. And this is an example of one of the method functions that implements a getter. In this case, it's going to call a cloud API for whatever crazy non-compatible legacy service this door lock actually uses, and then pass the answer back to HomeKit. So that's typically what you're doing, is you're wrapping some piece of proprietary garbage in a common protocol. The other way to do it is with Node-RED. And in Node-RED, you have a node type of a HomeKit accessory, which can implement any of the defined services. And then whatever sort of technology you have that Node-RED can talk to, and that can be Arduino and Raspberry Pi general purpose I/O pins and various kinds of network services, you can script your devices. So the last thing I want to show you is an example I've worked up over the last couple of days, which is I have a very nice projector screen, which unfortunately has a very stupid control mechanism. These days when you have an office like this with a retractable projector screen, you normally flick a switch, the screen comes down, it stops when it's finished. This one, you've got to hold the down button in, and it'll go down, and when it gets to the bottom, it'll grind its gears until you take it off the button. So somebody's got to stand there and push the button and know when to let go. And same when it's winding up. So what I've done here is I've gone, well, if I put a proximity sensor up near the ceiling and one down near the floor, I can tell when it's open, when it's closed. And then I connect an I/O pin to the two buttons. And so when I say, hey Siri, open the projector screen, and what I've done is I've used the I've used the window covering service, because it's essentially the same. It will turn on the motors, and then when it via this flow, and then when the sensor says the screen is all the way out, it'll send another message which turns off the motors. So that's a a MacGyver hack for retrofitting voice control to a relatively dumb piece of hardware that is electrically controllable.
Is that native
Node-RED,
or do you have to have like a plugin for
Node-RED
to get the support for that?
Yeah, you install Node-RED Contrib HomeKit to get that node type.
Yeah, cool.
So to recap, three big players: Apple, Google, Amazon. But Apple is the only one you can play with without having to grey market import some hardware. Accessories, seams, triggers for automating stuff. Huge ecosystem of plugins for HomeKit that let you talk to incumbent stuff. Raspberry Pi is good hardware. Orange Pi, if you're on an extreme budget. It's quite easy to build your own service for unsupported stuff. The examples and most of the services are literally two pages of code to get something working. And if that's too much code for you, then you can do some interesting stuff in Node-RED as well. So that's what I've got. So I'll put these slides up right away, and there's links to the code and some more information on some of the hardware that you might like. And I encourage you to get in touch if you've got a thorny problem that you're trying to automate and you want some advice. Okay, any questions? Yeah.
With your bridge thing, you still need there's not a clone for the Apple TV component. You need the Apple TV.
You don't need an Apple TV. You only need. I don't have a Generation 4 Apple TV. I've got one of the older ones, which doesn't work. So if you have a Generation 4 Apple TV, you can talk to its remote and say, "Hey Siri, turn on the bathroom, extract a fan." But I never take more than two steps away from my phone, so I just use my phone. The one thing that you get if you have a Generation 4 Apple TV that you don't get is the ability to automate triggers. So there needs to be something in the house that's running to be present to be able to do things like, oh, it's 2 o'clock, turn on all the sprinklers.
There's no clone for that.
No, there isn't. Nobody. I don't believe that part of the system has been reverse engineered yet. So as far as I know, there isn't anything to replace that. I did think about bringing along an Orange Pi and doing some stuff, but no, I haven't put that in the demo today. No internet toaster. Damn.
All right,
thanks, everyone.
Thanks very much, mate.